I've spent the last couple weeks testing out all the new features on iOS 15, but what I've been really focused on are the new privacy features. What I'm going to show you, you're only going to see on your iPhone or iPad after you've updated to the new iOS 15, and that becomes available sometime in late September. But right now I want to give you a sneak peek into the 6 new privacy features, some of which I really liked, and others I don't quite find as useful, and then actually show you how to use them on my device. Welcome to All Things Secured. My name's Josh, and despite the recent controversy about Apple's new child protection measures, which I've already done a video about, today I want to focus on the new privacy features that we do have access to in iOS 15. Most of what you'll hear on the internet about iOS 15 will highlight things like focus mode, the redesigned notifications, spatial audio, etc. But as with any new operating system, there are these tiny tweaks and changes that are being made that may not make the headlines because they're not very flashy or sexy, which makes me, a guy who's not very flashy and arguably has the kind of sexiness that only a wife could love, the perfect guy to share them with you. So with that saucy introduction, let's go ahead and dive in. The first big change I want to talk about here is how your updated device will work with Siri. From now on, all Siri requests will be processed on the device itself without having to be recorded or sent up to Apple's servers. One of the main reasons that I don't own an Alexa, a Google Home, a Facebook portal, or many of the other smart devices is because I don't like the idea that every word I say, every sound that's made in my house is possibly being recorded and stored in a server somewhere. It just doesn't sit well with me, you know? So now I can ask Siri to do things like open an app, find a maps location, or read a message, and since the requests are processed on the device, I not only gain a little bit of privacy, it's also faster, and it works even if my network coverage gets spotty. The next feature, called Mail Privacy Protection, is interesting because of how much controversy it's stirred up within the email marketing industry. You see, whenever you open an email on your phone or your computer, you often load images, sometimes an invisible pixel, that not only alerts the sender that the email was opened, but it can also be used to track your IP address with a general location. It's because of this that I can actually look at my email list and not only know who has opened my emails, but also generally where they're located in the world. With Apple's new mail privacy protection, all of this is about to change. Apple will now preload all content on proxy servers before you download it to your device, which will protect your IP address and keep the sender from knowing when or even if you opened the email. As far as the sender is concerned, at least the senders who are tracking the emails they send you, it will look like you opened pretty much every single one of the emails they sent you. And that means that from now on, the most important metric for them will be how often they can get you to click on a link or to reply to the email. Now, as somebody who sends emails myself and tracks open rates, I'm not sure if this will hurt or help you, the end consumer, since I use open rates to determine whether or not you're still interested in the content that I send and if I should keep on sending emails to you. It's also important to note that this only works if you use the Apple Mail app. If you happen to use the Gmail app or any other email app to send and receive email on your iPhone, mail privacy protection isn't going to work for you. Remember that. This is going to be a common theme throughout this video. Now, since we're on the subject of email, let's talk about Hide My Email. This is a feature which basically expands on the Sign In with Apple feature to be used anywhere online. All right, imagine if you could create infinite email addresses, use a unique email for every single login, and then maintain control of each of those addresses. That's what Hide My Email does. Let's say you visit All Things Secured and you want to download the privacy checklist we offer. While in Safari, as you fill in the form that you see here, you can click Hide My Email and Apple will automatically create a new email address that is forwarded to an email account that you choose. You still receive the emails, but now you haven't given away your real email address. And the real beauty of this is that you can log into your settings and take control of these proxy email addresses. You can change the label to be something you'll remember, change where it's forwarded to, what email address, make a note of why you gave them this email address, or even deactivate the email address if you no longer want the emails. Now, there are 2 downsides to using this feature. The first is that in order to auto-create these email addresses, you have to be using Safari as your web browser. Again, Apple is pushing us to use their native apps. Personally, I use Firefox right now, and while I can manually create these email addresses from within the Hide My Email settings page, that is not nearly as convenient. The second downside is that this is a paid feature. This and the new Privacy Relay, which I'll explain in a moment, are included as part of any iCloud plan, whether that's a standalone iCloud Plus storage plan or the Apple One plan. Personally, I think it's a great feature, and I love the ability to mask my email address, but since I don't use Safari as my default browser right now, it's not nearly as useful as it could be. My hope is that eventually the autofill will be expanded and made available to all the other browsers as well. And now that we're talking about paid iCloud features, let's just go ahead and cover Apple's Privacy Relay. Now, I've already talked about this in depth in my last video, which you should watch next, but the short of it is that Privacy Relay acts almost like a cross between a VPN and a Tor connection. In this case, your Safari internet traffic is encrypted, it's routed through Apple's servers where your IP address is stripped away, and then sent to third-party servers where they add a random IP address, decrypt the traffic, and then send it to the correct URL. The added privacy comes into play because Apple supposedly won't have the ability to know what websites you're accessing, but in the end, the third-party server, which in my testing has been Cloudflare, and the end website won't know your original IP address or have any way to identify you. Like I said, it's similar to a VPN or Tor, except that you don't have the ability to choose the location of that server where you're eventually going to access the internet, that third-party server. So with Privacy Relay, you do get some interesting privacy benefits, but it only works for what you do within the Safari browser, not any other app on your phone. And it doesn't provide any help with geo-blocking. Oh, and not surprisingly, this feature won't be available in countries like China, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and other authoritarian governments that feel threatened by this kind of feature. Now, I'm going to finish up with two final features that you're less likely to hear about in the mainstream media. The first is a feature that Apple is calling Secure Paste. You see, in previous versions of iOS and with pretty much all Android devices, what you keep on your clipboard, which is the last thing that you clicked copy on, was or is readable by the next app that you opened. Now, while this may not seem like a big deal, there are many people who use password managers or other means of storing passwords where they copy and paste it into the login form. They probably didn't realize it, but that copied password was viewable by other apps that they opened, and although that's not a huge security risk, it was a small loophole that has now been closed. Now your clipboard or pasteboard or whatever you want to call it is secured and inaccessible by other apps. The last feature is the app privacy report. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time on this because frankly, in its current form, I found this feature to be pretty much useless. Within my settings, if I scroll down and click on privacy, there's this new menu item on the bottom called Record App Activity. So when activated, it records a 7-day summary of what apps access your data, such as when they record your location or whatever you're saying through your microphone. Now, this would be really interesting data to see, and I'm sure it would be really helpful to determine any kind of foul play. But for now, when you download the report, which I did, and open it up, and you can see it here, it's really hard to understand. Instead of being the kind of beautiful graphical display that Apple is known for, this looks more like a log file that you download and send to customer support for troubleshooting. And maybe that's exactly what this is. So as a feature, I'm sure it's useful, but there's not much that I personally got out of it. So which of these six features do you find most useful? Do you use Apple's Mail app and Safari app enough that it makes sense for you? Leave a comment below to offer your thoughts and subscribe to All Things Secure because, you know, you care about your online privacy and security. Stay safe.